Welcome to the broadcast. We begin this evening talking about a new report from the Council on Foreign Relations about America's preparedness with our guest, Richard Clarke.
And this report asks for something else, which is a system, a process, so that we know what the standard is that we're trying to achieve in each city. A city of 500,000, a city of 1 million, a city of 10 million. What should each city, metropolitan area, have for police, fire, hospitals, emergency services, communications? Until we know what the standard is, we won't know how far away from it we are.
We conclude with the chairman of the President's Council on Bioethics, Leon Kass.
One of the reasons it's such a powerful book in all ages is that it absolutely obliges you to engage it. It's not self-interpreting. It sort of destabilizes your initial impressions of what you think is there if you're willing to spend the time with it. And although it is the basis of people who live by the book, it is the kind of book that is, in a way, should make scriptural literalists uncomfortable.
Clarke and Kass when we continue. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
Partnering with the nation's largest literacy organization and your local bottler, we're putting more than 1 million new books in the hands of children who need them most. Satisfying a thirst for a brighter future. The Coca-Cola Company.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
A new report released by the Council on Foreign Relations warns that the United States is not spending enough money to prepare for another terrorist attack. The report announced on Monday also concluded that the country remains dangerously unprepared to handle another catastrophic attack. Joining me now from Washington, Richard Clarke. He co-authored the report with former Senator Warren Rudman. Clarke is a former National Security Council official and an advisor on anti-terrorism and cybersecurity to the last three presidents. He is currently chairman of Good Harbor Consulting. I am pleased to have him join us now from Washington. Welcome.
Good to be back.
This is a central finding. Quote, nearly 2 years after 9/11, the U.S. is drastically underfunding local emergency responders and remain dangerously unprepared to handle a catastrophic attack on American soil, particularly one involving chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear, or high-impact conventional weapons. If the nation does not take immediate steps to better identify and address the urgent needs of emergency responders, the next terrorist incident could be even more devastating than 9/11. How many times do we have to be told that before somebody does something?
Well, that's kind of the point. One would have thought after 9/11 that all the things that we had been trying to get money for would have been funded. Certainly the war in Afghanistan got a blank check. But the war here at home didn't get a blank check, in part because the administration didn't ask for it. And so here we are almost 2 years after 9/11, and still fire departments, police departments, hospitals, emergency responders are, for the most part, as poorly equipped and trained as they were then. And in some respects, it's worse. Up to 80,000 police are being given their pink slips this year. And they're very much our first line of defense. So apparently...
How many, 80,000?
Over 80,000 police are being fired this year throughout the country.
Because cities and states are in terrible economic circumstances.
The economic downturn has had a very, very heavy impact on cities and on states. And they have to take cuts somewhere unless the federal government bails them out. And unfortunately, although the cuts are distributed across the city and state governments, it also means that fire departments and police departments and emergency responders are getting cut at the very time they should be increasing their capability.
Do you think Tom Ridge would agree with this assessment?
Well, Tom knows those are the facts. I don't think he argues with them.
Tom Ridge knows, head of Homeland Security, he knows that, in fact, that the administration could get the resources it needed if it asked for it, and the only reason it doesn't have them is it hadn't asked for them?
Well, Tom Ridge has to live within an overall federal budget. You know, I worked in the White House for 11 years, and I had similar frustrations. You ask the Office of Management and Budget for a certain amount of money, and you get less than that. And that's what's happened to Tom Ridge. He's asked OMB for a certain amount of money. They gave him less than he asked for. And now, when the president signs the budget and it sends it to the Congress, you have to be a good soldier, and you can't then slip around behind the back of the administration and ask for more. So Ridge is forced by the rules to live with the amount of money that he was allocated by the president and by OMB.
Should he have asked for more?
Well, he did ask for more. And the president should have asked for more, absolutely. But the Congress has an opportunity here in the next month or so to raise the amount of money above what the administration asked for. Now, the Department of Homeland Security criticized the Rudman Task Force by saying that we were looking for gold-plated telephones and we had grossly inflated numbers. Well, first of all, no one wants gold-plated telephones. We just want communications equipment that will save lives. Now, those firemen in New York on 9/11 died largely because their communications equipment didn't work. They couldn't get the message to evacuate the building on time. Now, that would happen again today in most American cities. And that's just unacceptable. We don't want gold-plated communications. We want reliable, secure communications, interoperable among departments, and communications that can get through in a crisis.
Okay, but here's what I'm asking this, and I think you may be, and I think you clearly are answering it. Is there a different assessment of the risk on the part of those who put this report together, chaired by you and Warren Rudman, and say the administration and Tom Ridge and his organization?
Well, that's a very good question. The problem is there is no assessment of the risk. Senator Rudman has been asking now for 3 years for a national risk study. And this report asks for it again. And this report asks for something else, which is a system, a process, so that we know what the standard is that we're trying to achieve in each city. A city of 500,000, a city of 1 million, a city of 10 million. What should each city, metropolitan area, have for police, fire, hospitals, emergency services, communications? Until we know what the standard is, we won't know how far away from it we are. What we're suggesting here in the report is rather than quibble about numbers, and we suggest that we need to quadruple the amount of money we're spending, but rather than say that that's right or the administration is right, let's establish a process so that we know the risk management approach that we're taking. This is all about risk management. And the Congress needs to be able to know, if it spends $10 billion more, what are we getting for that? How much closer do we get to the goal? How much faster do we achieve the goal? Right now, the administration is, in essence, asking the Congress to guess how much is enough. And that's just not the way to do it.
You did put a number on this, $98.4 billion.
We put $98.4 billion without the police. $98.4 billion for communications, 911, medical emergency response, hospitals, fire emergency response, planning, training, and equipment. But that does not include the police because we weren't able to derive a police figure.
Let me talk about risk and not an assessment first and then what to do about it. What's the tick off for me, the three things that worry you the most, having spent a considerable part of your government career at the National Security Council, and secondly, having been a central part of this study?
Well, the thing that is the worst case is probably the thing that's least likely to happen. But the thing that's the worst case is a dirty bomb, a radiological bomb, or a highly contagious biological weapon. Now, those are both hard to pull off, and they may not happen. We certainly hope they don't happen. But what if they did, and we were unprepared? As Senator Rudman said yesterday, after 9/11, if something like that happens again, or something worse involving radiological or chemical or biological, and the city in which it happens is not prepared, there'll be a political earthquake in this country.
Political earthquake means that what?
Well, people won't stand for the fact that having been forewarned and having had time to get things better, that we didn't do it. You know, right now we have these firemen, these policemen, these medical responders, these hospitals on the front line. It could happen tonight in any city. And as we went across the country and interviewed firemen and policemen and hospital workers, we found that they were terribly unprepared, and they knew they were unprepared. And so we're putting our frontline troops, in effect, on the line tonight without the equipment or the training they need. We'd never do that to the Army. Could you imagine sending the Army to fight Saddam Hussein without the equipment or training they need? The chemical biological gear, the training of how to use it? No, of course we wouldn't do that.
You would think that the country would be up in arms over its vulnerability. But my sense is it's not, that there it is not a hot-button issue.
I think it is,
American
Charlie.
Public.
I think it is, Charlie, if you ask them. You know, the American people believe that after 9/11, we woke up as a government and that we're now doing the necessary things. And they certainly hear the rhetoric coming out of Washington. They probably assume all of this is getting done. I think the average American would be frightened, shocked, and outraged if they knew how badly prepared their own city was.
So, in other words, you're basically saying that they assume that things are being done and they'd be frightened if they realized they weren't.
Well, I think that's absolutely right. But all they have to do is ask their police chief, their fire chief, their hospital director, their emergency planner, could you handle a major terrorist incident? Could you handle a biological incident? Could you handle a radiological incident? And the answer in every city, with perhaps the exception of New York and perhaps Washington, the answer is uniformly they're not ready.
Yeah. And you would think that in every city the political debate would be right on that target, because it is essential to, you know, the life of the city, and that there would be more public debate about that than whether we should be at war in Iraq or what we should do to change the policy after the fact in Afghanistan, or how much money we should spend on reconstruction in Iraq, or what might be the next target of opportunity.
You could argue about the war in Iraq as to whether or not that was something that actually was defending us or not. And that's, you know, something one can argue. But you can't argue that defending us in our own country is necessary. And right now, we're not doing that.
We're in a political season. Do you see any of the Democratic candidates, for example, that are out there using it as a rallying cry to say this country is not prepared, for all that we admire the Pentagon for its efforts in Iraq? We do not admire what the administration is doing to make us secure.
This isn't a partisan issue. I'm Senator Rudd.
No, I know, but it is the responsibility of someone who wants to lead the nation to call attention to important issues. You can't make it, it's not a question of whether it's partisan or not. It is a question of whether it's appropriate to point the finger at what is and is not being done, in the same way you would do it about how we fund a tax cut and all those kinds of things.
I haven't done a systematic survey of what the Democratic candidates have said. I've heard Senator Lieberman say this sort of thing, Senator Kerry, Senator Graham. But I've also heard, you know, Chris Cox, who is a Republican and chairman of the Homeland Security Committee in the House. And I've heard Republican senators saying this sort of thing. We heard it from Republican governors and Republican mayors as we went around the country. It's not a partisan issue. But it's a matter of how fast we get there. At the rate of current spending under the administration's plan, you know, we wouldn't get prepared until the year 2013. And the chances are something is going to happen a lot sooner than that.
Well, why isn't that the first thing that Tom Ridge says when he goes up before the Appropriations Committee?
Again, Tom has to live within the rules of the White House. He has to support the president's budget. He cannot ask for a penny more than is in the president's budget, just as that's true of every administration official. It was true of me.
But can he make them aware of the reality in the same way that you just said, by saying, look, you know, at the present rate we're spending within the budget that all of us have agreed on and the president has signed off on, it will be 15 years before, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, he won't say that because he doesn't have a process to quantify it. I come back to that. We need a process that allows him and allows the Congress to see how far away we are from where we want to be, and to answer in an empirical way the question, how much is enough and how much more do we get by spending $10 billion more? And people have said to us, you're talking about $98 billion more. Where does that come from? Over the same five-year period, the Defense Department is going to be spending $2 trillion to defend us overseas. I think it makes sense to take a look at Homeland Security and national security, all of one piece. and say, you know, $2 trillion to defend us overseas and this very, very small amount to defend us here where we live. Does that make sense?
Do you fear that we have one more report under the auspices of the Council on Foreign Relations chaired by two admirable patriots with deep experience in government, you know, a month from now, nobody will be talking. It will not have changed any minds, or it would not have caused anyone to move from, yes, I know that's true, to, yes, I'm going to do something about it.
Obviously, we hope we are going to have some effect. We did it to have some effect. And from what I can hear just in the last 24 hours from congressmen and senators, it's confirming their worst fears. And I think we're going to find, as the appropriations go through this year, that two things will happen. One, the Congress will spend more money than the administration has asked for Homeland Security. But as importantly, number two, the Congress will require the White House and the Homeland Security Department to come up with a process to determine standards in each city, to determine how much is enough, and to come up with a five-year plan that shows how we get from here to there. I think the Congress will make that a condition, will legislatively mandate that, so that when the budget is submitted next year, that plan will have to accompany it.
I suspect at every interview you've done, you've heard this question. Do you expect another terrorist attack on America as large or larger than 9/11?
I think it is only prudent to plan for it. And if we're wrong, then all of the capability we've built can be used for other things. There are lesser circumstances where you can still use that sort of thing, as we saw in the anthrax incident, as we see with hurricanes and whatnot. A lot of this capability is dual use. But for a prudent planner, we have to assume it could happen again.
Richard Clarke, thank you so much. It's good to have you on the program.
Thanks.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Leon Kass is here, trained as a physician and biochemist. He is now the Addie Clarke Harding Professor in the Committee on Social Thought at the University of Chicago. In 2001, he was appointed as chair of the President's Council on Bioethics. His new book is called The Beginning of Wisdom, Reading Genesis. I am pleased to have him at this table for the first time, and I look forward to doing it again. Welcome.
Thanks very much, Charlie. Pleasure to be with you.
Great to have you here. If you had written a book about bioethics, I would have said, I'm not surprised. Where does this idea of looking and helping us understand Genesis come from?
It's a real mystery to me, too, Charlie. As I indicate in the beginning of the book, I trained in medicine, trained in biochemistry, raised in a secular, non-religious home, no bar mitzvah, and was really a kind of child of the Enlightenment, regarded these sorts of things as interesting, but not for me. At a certain point in my life, when I began to see the great moral challenges that the new science was bringing us, and began to sense that there might be some deep limitations in modern science's view of the world and of human beings in particular, I didn't really turn to the religious texts as the alternative. I turned to ancient philosophy, spent 20 years working on Plato and Aristotle,
right,
and toward a more natural science. But as a result of some undergraduate teaching, where I had to teach this book in a Common Core course I taught with my wife, it suddenly occurred to me that this book didn't require you to be a committed believer in order to read it with understanding or with, more importantly, with profit. And that if I would suspend my disbelief about the truth of the matter and simply dealt with it and respected it as much as any other book, I might learn something from it. And gradually, the stories just got a hold of me. And after 5 or 6 years, I got up enough nerve to offer a seminar for credit at the University of Chicago, though I wasn't a biblical scholar. And I justified it by saying I wasn't cheating the students. We were going to sit here, read it, and try to make sense out of it and see what we could take away from it. Those turned out to be the best classes I ever taught. The stories, the characters just get under your skin, and they were a dinner table conversation in my home for years.
Give me an example of one that especially touched you and had relevance for you.
Well, You know, the question of man and woman is a vexed question of our age.
Yes.
And the story of the Garden of Eden is the story not just of the allegedly historically first man and woman, but in my reading, the paradigmatic man and woman. In fact, I regard some of the early stories in Genesis as being not so much about what happened once upon a time, but what always happens in the absence of other kind of instruction. So that I treat Adam and Eve as paradigmatic male and female. I treat Cain and Abel as not aberrant brothers, but that's the natural truth about brothers until somebody teaches them that brotherhood means something other than rivalry to the point of fratricide.
Yeah.
The Garden of Eden story was a real favorite of ours, and can't get to the bottom of it. No. The deeper you go, the deeper it is. And that's, I think, one of the great merits of this book, that the book is 50 chapters short. It's full of lacunae and ambiguities. If the book were longer, the commentary could be shorter. And I think one of the reasons it's such a powerful book in all ages is that it absolutely obliges you to engage it. It's not self-interpreting. It sort of destabilizes your initial impressions of what you think is there if you're willing to spend the time with it. And although it is the basis of people who live by the book, it is the kind of book that is, in a way, should make scriptural literalists uncomfortable because there's so much ambiguity, there's so much to ponder.
And in fact, I think you say that, in fact, if you're looking for the answers to specific questions, this is not the place to go.
Exactly.
If you're looking for wisdom, you have found a home.
Yeah, and looking for wisdom not in the sense that it's going to give you pearls that carry away, but it will help you understand in a much deeper way the fundamental elements of our humanity.
It's an easy question. Did it change your life? Did it change your approach to life? How did it make a difference?
Well, one would like to be
looking for Saul on the road to Damascus.
No, I think it's helped me. I was something of a rationalist, not entirely, not in a strict,
but a man of science.
But a man of science and a believer in the power of reason, whether of scientific reason or of philosophical reason, to get us to the bottom of things. And this book, among other things, holds up a mirror to such pretensions and makes you think it's not quite all that likely.
And where do you put it in that pantheon of things you talked about, Plato and others?
Well, it's been commonly said that Athens and Jerusalem are, in a way, the twin poles of the West. From Athens comes the spirit of reason and science, beginning in mathematics, Euclid and Plato. From Jerusalem, the belief in the unity of humankind under the one God and the call to holiness and righteousness. And I would say, while I still haven't given up my Athenianism, I'm wandering in this direction. My practice is still lame, but since I do think that a reader can begin this book thinking that the beginning of wisdom lies, as the philosophers would say, in wonder, a careful reader, even without previous training, might come to wonder whether the Bible isn't right when it says the beginning of wisdom is something like awe and fear and reverence.
Awe, fear, and reverence.
Yeah.
Who do you hope reads the book? Who is it intended for?
Well, I think especially intended. I think it's intended for believers and non-believers alike. The believers might say they don't need it.
You don't have to
be
of a particular faith.
Not at all. It's, I think, especially intended to be helpful to children of skeptics who... and we can go into this, who are hungering for something, who have certain spiritual longings or are looking for a certain kind of meaning.
Children of skeptics, meaning?
People whose parents or grandparents used to belong to a religious tradition and have rejected it or turned away from it. And these are younger people who, quite astonishingly now on campus, there are more and more young people who will own up to being sort of spiritually hungry and are looking for something larger than themselves that will give a kind of meaning to their life.
Why do you think that is? I mean, is it because of the material nature of our life? Is it because that of the rapidity and the velocity of science and change, that people are looking for something to hold on to in a world that is flashing in its brilliance and in its change?
It's partly that. This is an important sociological question, and I wouldn't pretend to really know it to the bottom. Partly, certainly my generation, I grew up in the immediate post-war years, and the promise of science and technology as somehow providing the answers to the dilemmas of the human condition, not just in the physical and biological science, but you remember the whole positivist movement, and that the social science was going to follow physics and chemistry, and we would have a science of the human being, and the dismal science of economics would be first, and then there would be psychology and sociology. That hasn't panned out. And I think a number of things over the last 50 years have cured people of the kind of utopian promise of a kind of rationalist solution to all of human troubles.
But can you, I can't tell you how many scientists have come here. Most recently, James Watson was here for a long conversation.
I saw that.
And can you aid in terms of where science and religion
meet?
Well,
I don't know that they meet. I mean, I think modern science to begin with, and it has a distinguished pedigree. It goes back really into the beginning of the 17th century. And its great genius was, in fact, to turn its back on the great questions that animated not just the religious traditions, but the pre-scientific philosophical traditions. The questions about the being of things, the questions of the why of things, the questions of the first cause. People like Descartes and Francis Bacon said those are unanswerable questions. We are so going to reconceive knowledge that we will figure out not what things are or why they are, but how they work so that we can have power over events and improve human life. Science has been spectacular at that. I esteem it highly. We're all the beneficiaries of its technological fruit, and though people think to the contrary, I'm not a Luddite by any means. But it has left those ultimate questions alone. And it is a kind of partial knowledge in the hands of some people masquerading as the whole of knowledge. Mm-hmm. But the questions that human beings still want to ask, science has no answers for by definition, by deliberate design.
By definition and design, meaning?
That it refuses to take up those questions.
Oh, sure, sure.
I mean, it has sort of said, that's for theology departments, that's for philosophy.
When it comes to faith, we cannot help
you. Or when it comes to the question of purpose or what is human flourishing. It can show you how to fix a bone, it can show you how to do various things that we need, but how one should live one's life is not a question that science is going to answer.
Has it made you more religious, if you can ask that? I'm not sure what it means, so
if I knew exactly what it means, I would answer. I mean, I have I'm more inclined to appreciate lots of things as mysterious rather than as transparent.
Treat things more as mysterious than transparent.
Than simply obvious. Right. Look, I believe in evolution, right?
You're a Darwinian.
I'm a Darwinian of sorts. I mean, I'm not sure that chance and necessity is the whole story. It may not be simply accidental that evolution moves in an upward direction and that you and I, as a result of ancestors that began in the primordial slime, sit here as rational and beings and largely understand each other. That's astonishing.
I know.
Astonishing.
Every 6 months I seem to pick up the newspaper and they found some other archaeological piece that gives them some new guidance as to when man, woman first began.
Right.
You know, I mean, and the recent discovery was confirming the African ascent.
Right. Well, I mean, look, science will tell us wonderful things about our past, wonderful things about how we work, but that there is, for example, intelligence and that little bits of sound that fly from over here, over there, carry units of intelligibility, and that we can talk and largely understand ourselves. Science is not going to give an account of that. Mm-hmm. It's not going to give an account of human love.
This is the kind of thing that takes place in locker rooms and in dormitories and in kitchen tables,
right,
all the time.
Right.
But how do you square this notion, or if you even come to it, both in the class you talk to the undergraduates,
right,
or this notion of if you're looking for relevance and you're looking for meaning and you're looking for where traditional understanding is versus religion, you know, how did life begin?
Well, one of the things that I try to suggest in the book is that, contrary to the general conception, the first chapter of Genesis, which is usually the target,
right?
I mean, the story of creation, is not an account that is offered as the equivalent of science. It's not an account that can be disproved, it seems to me, by science if read in the right way, nor is it an account that the creation scientists can find evidence for. The main purpose of the first chapter of Genesis is to declare that the sun and the moon and the stars are not gods, as most other people of that time thought, that these natural bodies are not the divine things, but that they are creatures. And it, in a way, polemicizes against the temptation to take your bearings to look up and worship nature. In that particular point, the Bible and modern science in a way agree. Nature, according to modern science, proceeds by certain kinds of iron laws and necessity. There are certain elements of contingency and chance. But we don't think the sun is a god, and we don't think that nature is somehow divine. Now, that's hardly the whole story of the first chapter, but I try at some length to suggest that, in fact, one of the questions I really ask myself is, can a thoughtful person today still believe in the teachings of the Bible?
Exactly.
Right?
Can
an enlightened person
exactly.
still believe? Well, the answer to that depends in part on what the Bible says. And if the stakes are high, you don't rely on hearsay.
Yeah.
You sort of sit down and ponder it. And I think I've developed an account of the first chapter, not because that's where I wanted to come out, but that's what I think I discovered there. It says, look, there's nothing that I know as a scientist that requires me not to follow and somehow trust that account for what that account most has to show us. The most important thing in that is that being is somehow hierarchic, that man is higher than the sun, that man is somehow the most godlike of beings, because he somehow participates in freedom and reason and concern and judgment, like the story says the Creator does.
Let me take that and turn it to the other part of your life that interests me, which is your official job coming from the White House and the stem cell decision specifically.
Okay.
What did the president ask of you?
You mean
when the stem cell decision was going to be made by him? Did he ask you for guidance? Did he ask you to what you thought? Or
he asked me and someone else to come and have a conversation in his presence on the moral issues that were involved and how to think about the competing claims in the conversation. He didn't ask my opinion of what he should do.
He said, come have a conversation.
That's correct.
Just like that?
He wanted to hear something argued out in front of him so that, he talked to lots and lots of people. He talked to scientists, he talked to patient advocates, he talked to church leaders, and he wanted a couple people in bioethics to come and have this conversation in his presence.
This is the way it was couched at the time. This was pre-9/11. It was couched as one of the most important decisions of his presidency.
That's correct.
At the time.
That's correct. And I think people have misunderstood what happened there. People regard, or the press, I think, has really misunderstood the decision. They've treated it as a political compromise.
Right.
Whereas I think that it was a moral solution. Let me try to explain. The president believes that one should not destroy nascent life. And the question was, if you believe that, can you somehow support with federal funds research on cells that have been derived from embryos that have already been killed? It's a kind of classical example that the moral philosophers have discussed for centuries. Can you participate in the benefits of some act regarded as evil without being cooperative in it, complicit? And the moral tradition, in fact, this is not my
tradition.
That
someone would regard as evil.
That someone would regard. Well, in the president's case, I think he
right.
does.
Yeah,
right?
He, right.
And the Jesuits, as I subsequently learned, argue that, yes, you can under certain strict conditions. First of all, that you not yourself participate in the evil act, that you don't do the embryo destruction. Second, that you don't abet its continued performance by allowing funding, by offering a financial incentive
for more people to do it.
For more people to do it. And third, you reaffirm the moral principle that has here been violated. And in that little speech he gave on August 9th, it really was quite a remarkable speech. It was 10 minutes, the president is a kind of moral teacher of the nation, and about until 9 minutes into it, you didn't know which way he was going to come out because each side...
Did you not know?
I didn't know.
You did not know?
I didn't know. Well, I did know that day or the 2 days before that he had asked me would I serve as the chairman of the council.
Right.
And it was not a job I was looking for, but having spent 30 years in bioethics, when the president of the United States asked you to do something like that, there was no hesitation.
Did he ask you that because of the relationship that grew out of a prior...
I don't...
Or because of this specifically thought you had handled this?
I really don't know why exactly. I mean, I was very active in the cloning.
You basically said, I accept not. Why did you ask?
I didn't say why did you ask. I had been very active on the cloning front.
Yes.
I've been an opponent of human cloning for 35 years. Almost my first little bit of pen to paper was on
right.
why we shouldn't clone human
right.
beings.
Right.
And I had been actively trying to lobby on the legislation. I testified several times in Congress, and I think it was that brought me to their attention. I was interested in cloning. They were interested in stem cells. I think the important thing about the stem cell question is this. We can't afford to be cavalier with the suffering of people with serious illness. But we can't also be casual about what we owe to nascent human life. And this is a real dilemma. It's a real dilemma. None of us, I think, would want to live in a world in which the seeds of the next generation are regarded just as raw material for our benefit.
You and Irv Weissman have had some dialogue about this.
We have. We've talked.
Now, what's the essential difference between the two of you? Where does it come down to?
I don't think Irv Weissman regards the early stage human embryo as anything more than cells. And therefore...
That's why I'm asking. Is that, right. in your judgment, the essence of the difference?
I think that's right. And while I don't regard the earliest embryo as one of us,
right.
I don't know how to regard it. I regard it...
So after a month of pregnancy, you don't know?
Oh, I would...
When would you not know?
No, I... What should I say?
Well, let me tell you one thing that's
please.
Fascinating.
Please.
This has been raised by people, and
right.
we saw it on the show. The extraordinary photography available today.
Oh, it's amazing.
Is having an amazing sense of the creative process.
Right.
It is stunning to me to sit here and watch.
From fertilization onwards. There are no...
Any honest biologist would say.
Seriously. That doesn't mean that you
there's
don't...
There's a continuity.
That there's continuity. That there's a continuity. That there are no somehow magic markers where if you cross this line,
right.
you suddenly have a person.
Right, right.
Okay? From a biological
from
point of view...
From one cell becomes many.
From one... Yeah. You and I began as one cell.
Right.
That little one cell had the capacity for conversation eventually.
Right.
Astonishing. Astonishing. For myself, that very fact leads me to treat even the earliest stages of life with respect. Even though, and I don't know whether I should call it a human being at the earliest stage or some something on the way to becoming human, but I absolutely insist that there is a moral question here.
But do you have respect for Irv Weissman's point of view?
Irv Weissman's point of view is that the imperative of doing the research to healing the suffering trumps.
Right.
And he may be right.
That the payoff in terms of healing the suffering and saving lives trumps.
He may be right. He may be right in that judgment.
But is he right in saying, therefore?
Yeah, therefore what you're working on is nothing, to the extent to which I don't...
Therefore, we need to be more subtle in our sense of what we're doing.
Well, how shall I put it? I would not choose to define an embryo as a non-embryo just so that I can feel good about destroying it. Now, if we want to destroy the embryos, let's be very clear what we're doing. Let's not pretend that they're mere cells. Mm-hmm. Regard them as nascent human life, and if you have a compelling reason to destroy them, then you have to bear the burden of proof, rather than say, this is just tissue. Okay. That
brings me to an interesting question,
please.
To me. That was 2000, what? That was 2000?
2001.
2001, early 2001.
Right.
We're now in middle 2003.
Correct.
Do you see it? What has time done to your
thoughts on this? Well, the council is in the midst of a review of monitoring stem cell research, and I want to wait until the evidence is in. We have, in fact, in our July meeting, going to have several scientific presentations on adult stem cell research as well as embryonic stem cell research. I think, and my final judgment will depend upon hearing what's there. We have an analysis of the ethical arguments since 2001 But
has anything happened scientifically to lead us anywhere different?
There are exciting preliminary results with the adult stem cells and with the embryonic stem cells, both, by the way, with the lines that the president has approved for funding.
In terms of, in other words, the consequences of the excitement comes from analysis and observation of those 64 lines.
Well, 64 were legitimate for funding. Only 11 are, in fact, characterized and available.
Okay.
But conversation I had with Irv Weissman before the president's decision, he thought that there were maybe 10 or 15 lines in existence in the world, and he thought that they would be plenty to do the research with. These 11 lines now available through NIH are, in fact, being used around the world.
Yeah.
And the president's decision has, in fact, liberalized the policy such that research now can go on. So those lines are being used, and there aren't really any experiments that anybody's proposed to do that can't be done with those lines.
There are no experiments that are not being done right now because those lines didn't provide ample material.
That's correct. And that was the material.
Nobody will step forward and say, if I had more lines, I may be able to find, I'm a credible source, I may be able to find a way that we can develop stem cells that will cure
Let me be careful. There are people who say that if I had a stem cell line that carried a specific disease, I might be able to work on the development of that disease. But one can get those stem cell lines with diseases out of the adults who carry those diseases. That's one of been the very exciting new thing in the last couple of years, is that your body and my body carry stem cells that, just like the embryonic stem cells, can turn into heart muscle and brain cells and liver cells and so on. And it's possible to isolate these cells from afflicted patients and begin to do the developmental work on that.
This is not an issue in terms of the president's decision, but has what we have found out in the 2 years since early 2001 given encouragement to the potential of the medical benefits of harvesting stem cells?
Absolutely.
The promise of stem cell is being delivered.
Let's be careful.
Okay.
Let's be very careful. One of the very horrible things, and I'm glad for an opportunity to say this, one of the really horrible things about the debate is the way in which many of the supporters of stem cell research have hyped the promise and exaggerated the degree to which people now suffering stand to benefit. John Gerhardt, who is one of the great stem cell researchers, has said in public, it's very unlikely that very many people, if any, now alive, suffering from these diseases, will find their cures from stem cell research in their lifetime. From an embryonic stem cell research in their lifetime.
Will find relief in their lifetime.
In their lifetime. And it's not, I don't want to throw cold water on these hopes.
And that is because of the fact, but before we talk about that, that is because of the fact that is taking, it'll take that a long time for us to figure out how to use
this. You start with a stem cell which can become any cell. You then have to figure out how reliably to grow it into a nerve cell. You've got to figure out how to make sure that it doesn't carry, the nerve cell population doesn't still have some undifferentiated cells in there that could become tumors. You have to know how to deliver it so that it's not rejected. You have to know how to put it in multiple animal models to make sure it functions right and does only what you've wanted it to do. This is not like if you discovered a new antibiotic in the era of tuberculosis where you have a kind of magic bullet for it. This is a long and arduous problem. But
the obvious question is how long?
That I'm not in position to say, but the researchers who are working on this will tell you it's decades.
So they're enthusiastic about the potential.
Exactly.
You know, and sanguine about the timeliness.
And they want the research to go forward, and nobody can blame them.
And no research is not going forward because, other than the exception you talked about?
Most of the experiments, this I think I learned from talking to the people in NIH, they have geared up in a rapid, made more rapid efforts to gear up a stem cell research program in the light of the president's decision.
This was one of those interesting, important decisions that found strange bedfellows. I mean, conservatives who might have been expected, in some cases, to be opposed because of whatever personal circumstance, were in favor of encouraging stem cells and wanted the president to go further.
Right.
Others who you might have thought to be opposed, to be in favor of it, were perfectly happy with the president's decision.
Right. No, I mean, it was, as I think, a decision made based on principle. But I think the president also didn't want to stand in the way of exploring these opportunities. And by the way, stem cell research is, and not just stem cell research, even cloning is legal in the private sector.
I'm going to go to cloning now, because my time is limited.
Okay.
And you said a long time opponent of human cloning. Has any human cloning taken place as far as you know?
No.
So
there have been these claims.
I know.
These are kooks.
These are kooks.
Kooks.
Oh, kooks. Oh.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
So as far as you know?
As far as I know, those claims last Christmas time were a fraud.
Right. As far as you know, do you believe that it will happen? Not with the approval or sanction of any responsible person or body, but will happen?
Well, I think the jury is out on that one. It's turned out to be much more difficult to clone mammals, to clone primates than anybody had thought. Lots of species have been cloned, 8 to 10 at last count.
8 to 10 species, what are they?
Sheep, cows, goats, rabbits, mice, several of the others.
That gives an example.
But no primates.
Right. Why is it so much more difficult?
Well, it has something to do when you put a differentiated nucleus into an egg. That nucleus, which was making skin cell type proteins, now has to sort of go in reverse and revert back to being like the nucleus of a fertilized egg. And the process of what they call the reprogramming of the nucleus back to its original multipotent condition is tricky. And apparently, the putting of the nucleus in sometimes damage some of the cell apparatus that's required. So it's been very hard. Now, the human might be different, and there are several doctors who claim that at the moment they're trying to clone a human being.
Several doctors?
Several physicians.
Outside of the United States?
One of them is an American citizen, but doing it outside of the United States.
Why do they want to do it?
Because
of science moves forward?
No, I don't think for science. I think this is
personal.
A kind of notoriety and a certain kind of grandiosity to do what can't be done.
Give me your strongest argument against it.
Well, I would say two. I think it's a major step in the direction of sort of turning human procreation into manufacture, in which we use the blueprint of a life that's already been lived and try to adapt the new life to conform to it. Whether it works or not to produce the copy, that's another matter. The intention is somehow that. And second, it seems to me that, of course, it's unsafe at the moment, but that's not an objection to cloning as such. That's an objection to the procedure.
Right. Unsafe in terms of the end result may be much
deformed,
more deformed,
right.
Disfigured.
Yeah. But most people are not opposed to cloning because they think it won't work well. They're opposed to it should it work well. They don't like the idea that children would be robbed somehow of that unique identity and individuality, which is the biological foreshadowing of the kind of independent life that all of us have had.
Let me take you back to in vitro fertilization.
Right.
You were opposed to that or not?
Mixed. Opposed on the first grounds because I thought it was an unethical experiment on the child-to-be. One didn't know if it was safe.
Today?
Today, I'm 5 years after that, when Louise Brown was born, I wrote my second article and endorsed its use for the treatment of intramarital infertility, though I called attention to the fact that now that we had human life in human hands, there was probably no limit on what we could subsequently do to it. As a treatment of infertility, I have no problem with it, though it is, by the way, a very strange thing we've gotten used to. We've gotten used to it.
We don't think about it.
We don't. Look, with the best techniques available for detecting the onset of pregnancy, Charlie, the earliest you can do it is about between 7 and 10 days. The embryo in vivo arrives unbidden, mysteriously, takes up residence unannounced, and nobody can know that he's there. That's somehow fitting to what it means, I think, to make way for new life. It arrives not because you've chosen it, not because you've decided to handle it. We are now getting used to getting our hands on the beginnings of human life.
We start
just by putting the egg and the sperm together, right, and do a little end run around the oviduct blockage, right, and put the little guy back in there and let him grow up. And it doesn't look like very much. But now that he's out there and you can actually see when he arrives when the sperm penetrates, you can see that under the microscope, we now have the sense that this is somehow ours to control. We are now doing testing of embryos to decide which ones pass muster, to begin with to rule out certain kinds of severe genetic diseases like Tay-Sachs. I understand the importance of that. On the other hand,
you're moving towards this idea that we're playing God.
No, that we're beginning to exercise. Well, you can call it that. But pretty soon, with the Human Genome Project completed, we're going to be able to screen little 8-cell embryos for thousands of possible genes. We already can screen to decide whether it's a boy or a girl and implant only those.
And therefore make decisions.
And make these decisions. To what kind of children we're going to have. Not just whether to have a child, but what kind of a child our children ought to be. And you can call that playing God, or you can call it on the road to despotism of parents over children. It's an awesome responsibility to be responsible for their rearing.
And here's what else is awesome. Who should decide, and how do you come to grips with the issue?
Well, look, this is the question of questions for a liberal democratic society that believes in technological progress, believes in medicine, believes in human freedom. We are acquiring awesome powers, not just to heal disease, but to begin to remake our own nature. Up till now, we've been the beneficiary of unregulated and full steam ahead. But the question is whether we can have all of these benefits and not walk down the road in the direction of Brave New World. If we allow things to be done that can be done and don't make some kind of an effort to get a human handle on where this train is going, we'll wind up in a destination none of us wants to get to, and we might not even know it.
Thank you for coming.
Charlie, thank you very much for having me.
Pleasure. Let me just say, the beginning of wisdom, where we started, is that Leon Kass, as I said, the Addie Clark Harding professor in the Committee on Social Thought in the College of University and the College of the University of Chicago, and the Herzog Fellow in Social Thought at the American Enterprise Institute, currently chairman of the President's Council on Bioethics. Three books, most recently Life, Liberty, and the Defense of Dignity, The Challenge of Bioethics, and co-author of two more. I am pleased to have you on this program.
And sure, it's been a pleasure.
Hope we can
enjoy
do this
talking
again.
With you. I'd love to.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
Partnering with the nation's largest literacy organization and your local bottler, we're putting more than 1 million new books in the hands of children who need them most. Satisfying a thirst for a brighter future. The Coca-Cola Company.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, we'll talk about summer movies and then a conversation about politics and the Democratic contenders with Adam Nagorny and Mark Halpin. Join us.